The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can download the Radio Lex app on your smartphone device. Man, oh man, what a beautiful, beautiful day it is in Lexington, Amber. It's days like this that makes you want to go outside, sit down, eat, just enjoy the weather.
Maybe have a nice beer on a patio.
On a patio, yes. It's days like this, you want to sit out on the patio or sit out on the front porch.
Well, I don't know about the front porch, but I'll take the patio.
Or a deck, a nice deck.
A nice stained deck, that would be nice.
Yes. Well, last week we started talking about the coronavirus. I remember opening the show and talking about maybe some things that we should worry about when it comes to people getting sick. Now the coronavirus has spread. Yep. It's now considered a pandemic.
It is.
And it is now, the latest report I've heard is it's in Tennessee.
Yes, we have one quarantine case in Tennessee.
Things are not looking good for Tennessee really altogether.
I mean, with their basketball team and now coronavirus, probably not.
Well, and not only their basketball team, I wasn't even talking about that, but that's funny. They did beat us, by the way.
I know, that's why I had to be salty.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. They did beat us, but not only do they have coronavirus there, but Amber, the tornado, the twister that happened in Nashville.
Well, what bothered me the most about that was it happened during the night. And I feel like that's probably the time that I'm the most vulnerable, is like dead middle of sleep. So I couldn't imagine what it felt like for some of those people. Like, that's what you're awakened to, is something ripping through your house.
Tornadoes touched down across Tennessee on Tuesday, killing at least 24 people. The death count is up to 24 people now, and leaving an undetermined number missing, according to authorities. Tennessee was under a state of emergency. That is sad. 24 people lost their lives. When I used to think of a tornado, I used to think of the Wizard of Oz. Just a house spinning around in a twister, and it would end up on the other side of the rainbow.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
But that's not how it is. It's horrific. It literally is, it can tear a community apart in seconds.
Yep.
And to think Nashville, a place that's lively and upbeat and where you see people always having a fun time, to see such disaster happen is so sad.
Well, I just think that with, you know, all of our given kind of where we're sitting at now, not only with, you know, climate change and, you know, obviously we've got a new virus on the horizon that we're dealing with, and now we're starting to see these natural disaster upticks again. And I just always get very fearful when I start to see these things kind of happen in threes.
Yeah, it says that a majority of the deaths occurred in Putnam County, east of Nashville. County Mayor Randy Porter said at a press conference on Wednesday that 18 people were killed in the county, including 5 children under the age of 13. And he said that no additional victims were found overnight. So that's what's, you know, scary about this, is that's what the death count is up to. And I think they have found everybody. I hope so. I know that there's still people missing.
Yeah.
I mean, but I guess there would be hope if you found people if they were alive.
Yeah.
And sometimes just finding people gives people closure, dead or alive.
Yeah, the
just
closure.
Just finding them. So my heart and my prayers go out to those people in Tennessee. It really is very, very sad, Amber. Doing this radio show, I think most people know that I am from Knott County, Kentucky, and so are you.
I'm
from Eastern Kentucky. And whenever I see a story from my home county, it just intrigues me. I want to talk about it. It intrigues me. And I saw this story, and it happened a little bit ago, February 19th, actually, but I want to talk about it now. A Kentucky teenager. His name was Corey Joseph Gotze, and he died after being attacked by an animal in Knott County. Police said that the young boy, 13 years old, was found dead on a mountainside behind someone else's home in the Emelina community on Montgomery Creek Road Tuesday, according to a statement from the Kentucky State Police. They found his body Amber, several hundred feet up a hillside in a wooded area. Mm-hmm. And they determined that it was from an animal attack. It was like canine teeth marks is okay. kind of what they determined it from. I don't know. Could you imagine how horrific that would be, first of all, to be attacked by an animal?
No, absolutely not.
And I've always, you know, growing up in Eastern Kentucky, my dad used to joke around with me all the time that there was things up in the mountains that we had no idea what was up there.
Oh, yeah.
And now I'm realizing, you know, he wasn't joking.
No, they weren't joking. It was just that was much easier for our minds to comprehend, like, oh, boogeyman's up there. But really, it was actual, you know, coyotes, wolves. I mean, we have a lot of elk.
You don't know what is up in those mountains, no. Especially if you're from Eastern Kentucky. If you grow up in a place that's a very woodsy area, and you grow up where there's a lot of woods just in general around you, you don't know what's up in them. Have you been in them? And if you've been in them, how long have you stayed up in them? So you don't know really what's out there. So it's untelling what got a hold of this little boy. They still don't know what it was.
Yeah.
They still don't. It could have been a coyote.
Yeah.
It could have been a dog.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's scary. It's scary. Do you have any inkling of what you think it might have been?
If I was a betting woman, I would probably say that it was coyotes. I know that we have an overpopulation right now, not only in Eastern Kentucky, but I think this is kind of something that's affecting multiple regions. So if I was a betting woman, I would say, unfortunately, this is probably a coyote incident.
Well, police warn the community to remain hypervigilant, but do not believe there is any immediate threat. So they don't think that there's something out there lurking, just looking to attack people. They're pretty much saying this little boy was in the wrong place at the wrong time. But it makes me think about just animal attacks altogether.
Yeah.
You are a pet owner.
I am.
You own dogs, you own cats. But sometimes you hear of dogs attacking people. And I get it. Sometimes dogs, they're attacking because they're watchdogs or they're trying to protect their owner. But what do you think about animals that attack people for no reason? What should happen to these animals and what should be done to these animals?
If an animal is attacking another human being for no reason, then, you know, I love my animals. My animals are my family, so it's very hard for me to say this, but, you know, there are proper procedures. We need to make sure that we check to see if this animal has any type of rabies, because, you know, that can be fatal to humans.
Yeah.
You know, and we've got to think about, you know, the steps we need to take to get these people proper treatment. So in that instance, if it's an unprovoked animal attack, and this was a misconception I used to have. What do you think should have to happen to an animal if there's a suspected bite?
After investigation, after finding out that it was just malicious from the animal,
yeah.
That the animal just bit somebody for no reason.
Yeah.
I believe that that's a hard one, but I believe that the animal should be, I'm going to get crucified for this when I say this.
I'll take it okay. For you. Back home in Eastern Kentucky, we used to assume and we would act under the assumption that if an animal bit a human being, we needed to immediately exterminate the animal.
Yeah, put it down.
And remove the head, because, you know, the brain is what we're going to be testing to see if they have rabies.
Right.
So that's always, you know, like, you know, kill it, let's get it out, let's get it up to the state. That's not the procedure. That's actually not how it's done. But if it's an unprovoked attack, yeah, we've got to think about the human being. Like, let's get treatment started. Let's get things rolling.
So what should happen to the animal, though? Should you put the animal down?
Yeah, the animal's going to have to be put down.
I agree with that. Yeah,
And I don't think it's not necessarily from a medical standpoint that I think the animal should be put down, but it's a temperament issue, because this will consistently be an issue.
Right.
Now,
yep.
If you are provoking my animal.
Right.
And my animal defends themselves, that's completely different.
That's different.
I will not put my animal down, and I will fight you every step of the way legally to ensure that my animal does not get put down.
I agree. And I do agree with you. If it is the dog just deliberately and maliciously attacking the human being, then yeah, the dog needs to be put down because there is a mental issue with that dog, because dogs aren't ferocious like that for no reason.
No.
They're not ferocious like that for no reason. So yes, they should be put down. And you know, I'm glad that you say that, because I feel like that sometimes we live in a society where we can watch a movie and watch people get slaughtered and their head cut off, but somebody steps on the paw of a dog and everybody goes crazy. They're like, "Oh,
well, now I am that person.
Did you see that poor little puppy?" and some guy just got his throat slashed, and everybody's like, "Ooh, wow, whoa, that was cool." But then the dog gets, you know, the dog goes, "Erp," and everybody goes crazy.
Are you making fun of me?
No, you're not. A lot of people are like that. So yeah. It's just, I'm glad to hear you say, okay, you're putting a human being in front of an animal.
Yeah.
Based on that's a very logical answer.
It's not about which life matters most, because, you know, in my eyes, I think a life is a life is a life, and I am not in any position to take a life,
yeah,
whether it be from a human or whether it be from a canine. That's not on me.
And let me be clear, the situation you're saying, it has to be thoroughly investigated before we put this animal down. Just because your animal bites somebody, a stranger in your house, that doesn't constitute
to shoot it and make it be miserable.
Right.
No, there's a quarantine process you can go through.
Right.
There are proper procedures that need to be taken, but I understand that emotions are usually very high in situations like that, because 9 times out of 10, it's going to be kids that get bit.
Mm-hmm.
It's usually always kids.
But usually it's kids messing with the dog. They're pulling on the dog's ears or their tail, and the dogs are very friendly, but, you know, and sometimes they don't mean anything by their bite.
No.
They just are trying to just kind of give you a little slap on the wrist, like, "Stop,
yeah,
that hurts.
Hey, quit.
That hurts when you're pulling on my tail," so they might give you a little bite to your arm. Nothing crazy, but that doesn't constitute for the animal to be put down. So I see. But yes, the whole point of this is, it is scary, first of all, what happened to this little boy. It is. If it was a dog, it makes it even scarier, because dogs are everywhere. But I don't know exactly the whole story of how this happened. They said that he wasn't from Knott County. He wasn't from the area, but he was familiar with the area.
Yeah.
So he knew his way around just a tad. But like we said, it's untelling what's up in those mountains. Anything could have come out of that mountain and grabbed him.
Exactly.
And I don't know if he got lost, if he was playing in the woods, playing in the hills. I mean, think about how many times we used to play in the hills when we were little.
Oh, every day.
And I don't know if that's what happened, if he got lost. Could you imagine how scared, I mean, you'd be just getting lost? Remember when you were a kid, how scary it was to be like in Walmart and you turn around and your mom or dad was nowhere to be found?
You know, it's hilarious that you say that, because I think everybody has a traumatic "I got lost as a kid" story.
Everybody has one of those.
Mine, I think, is a little above and beyond.
Yeah.
I got lost when I was about 5 in Walmart in Prestonsburg.
I know you screamed and cried.
Oh, no, I probably didn't, because I was willing to go with anybody other than going home with my mommy. So.
But you know, what's scary, what's so crazy about that, when you're younger, you don't, all rationale and all logic goes out the window when your parents, when you can't see them, because all you really got to do is just go up to the front and say, "Hey, I can't find my parents," and they'll keep you right there until your parents come. But you can't think about that when you're 4 or 5 years old. You think that you're never going to see them again.
You're never going home again.
You're never, that's it.
Yep.
And I remember someday, I feel like when I go to Walmart, it's like every other like trip to Walmart, I see some little kid experiencing this. I see some little kid.
See that sheer panic in their face.
And it's funny, because you know that it's funny, because they really think it's over. But you see them running through the hallway, through the aisles, "Mommy!"
No, I've never done that.
Oh, yeah. You hear them screaming, because you really think you've lost them.
Well, but I think we've kind of lost a little bit of that, unfortunately, now, because all these kids have cell phones now.
Yes.
Call you mommy, text you mommy.
That's all you...
I'm in the kitty section.
That's all you got to do now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, back in the day before cell phones and texting, that was it.
Yeah, you had to look around.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I did really get lost in Walmart one time, and you know she sent my brother to guard the front door. You know if he'd have sent me just to come, and he'd have let me walk right on out them doors. Bye-bye.
He would have let you leave.
Yep. Bye-bye, sissy. See you later.
Yeah.
Some man just tater-toting me on out.
Yeah. But yeah, people, and I think sometimes parents like to mess with their kids that are mean. You know, when kids are real mean in stores, because I used to be a real mean little kid in stores. I used to hide in the clothes and make my mom think that somebody stole me.
Oh.
And I would have been really salty if somebody did steal me.
So now what happened when people were perusing through those clothes and you were just sitting in there? Did they look at you like you were weird?
There was an old lady that actually did find me in the clothes one time.
What'd she say?
I don't know. It was back when the Walmart, remember when Walmart used to have carpet?
Yes.
Remember that?
And you had like the tiled floor.
Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know why I said that. I just remembered that's what the floor looked
like. You set the mood then.
Yes.
So now I know what era we're talking about.
Exactly. But that was very scary, getting lost as a kid. Sheer panic, no doubt. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have to take our first break and we'll be right back after these words. Stick with us.
Say, before I say farewell, I'll give you one more day so you can find out.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me.
If you don't find
Amber,
what's happening,
I don't know how familiar you are with daytime television, because we talk about daytime TV from time to time.
Every now and again.
Every now and then. We talked about Jerry Springer and Sally Jesse Raphael and Ricky Lake and all those great shows that are on daytime TV. But when all of those shows went away, when Ricky Lake and Jerry and Jenny Jones, when all of those shows went away, which is a sad day, by the way.
Very sad.
Those shows don't exist anymore. But when all of those shows left, they had to be replaced with something. And one of the things that they were replaced with was courtroom TV shows.
Yes.
Courtroom TV shows. I'm talking like Judge Judy, Judge Joe Brown,
Judge Mathis,
Judge Mills Lane, and now even Judge Jerry, because Jerry Springer now has went to, from being Jerry Springer to doing his own courtroom TV show. But yes, courtroom TV shows kind of paved the way for reality TV.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, why wouldn't anybody want to watch a judge show? It makes sense that television loves the courtroom. It's a natural setting for drama. It's with real life stakes and it's with gripping interaction, Amber.
Oh yeah.
It's so fun to watch. And I really do think it might have paved the way for reality television. But I bring it up because the queen of the court, Judge Judy, is retiring after 25 seasons, Amber. She is saying goodbye to her show, Judge Judy. She says that she's done it enough. 25 seasons, she's gave CBS 25 years worth of reruns, which they're going to still show her show.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's still going to be on the air. She's not going anywhere.
No.
The show is still going to be around. There's just not going to be any episodes filmed.
And honestly, I didn't know that she was still filming new episodes.
Oh.
So that's kind of a surprise to me.
I knew she was when she came out rocking that new hairdo she had. The ponytail?
See, you got to think, I've not watched it in so long. Well, I've probably not watched it since 2010.
Well, she's had that same haircut since, like, 1964.
Looks like she's a school teacher.
She does. She does. And she looks like the old woman that sits behind you in church that sings off key, too.
Yes.
She's that woman. But she changed her hairstyle. She now has a ponytail.
Oh.
Yeah. And that's how I knew she was filming new shows. But yeah, she's decided that 25 years as being the queen of daytime is enough. She is saying goodbye. Listen at this, though, Amber. I don't think Judge Judy gets the credit that she deserves. She literally might be the queen of daytime television. She had the highest rated daytime talk show for years. She was beating out people like Oprah Winfrey.
Oh, wow.
She was beating out everybody, pretty
much.
See,
that's who I was going to ask. Are we comparing her to Oprah?
Yes.
But if we are, then
as a matter of fact, she was getting higher ratings than Oprah. She was getting an average of 10 million viewers an episode. Imagine turning on these mics knowing that 10 million people are listening to you.
I don't know that I could do that.
Yep.
I think that would be daunting.
10 million people watched her show every day. I mean, why not? It really was good stuff.
Oh, gosh. And when she'd get mad and she'd start just laying the mommy law down to you, that's when you knew it was over.
That is one woman that really I would put up against anybody in an argument.
Yes.
The queen of debate. The queen of intimidation.
Well, she didn't really even debate with you because she would let you talk for about 5 seconds, and then she could just flat out stop you.
Yeah, literally. And she used to say her famous line, "Don't pee on my leg and tell me it's raining."
Exactly.
And she used to be, before she got her star, before she became a star and the host of her own daytime TV show, Judge Judy, she used to be a real lawyer. I mean, and she's a real judge still, but she actually went to law school,
yeah,
graduated top of her class while raising a family, and became a judge in New York City. And she presided over family court and became the judge in the Manhattan and downtown, yeah, Manhattan of all family courts. And her no-nonsense attitude got her her own show. Basically, 60 Minutes did a feature on her.
Yeah.
And CBS loved that feature so much, they're like, wow, let's make this woman, let's bring her on CBS and give her her own show.
I just want to know how much of it was actually real.
I've looked into that. That's okay. A good question. How much of it is real? Well, you know, they do say the cases are real. The people, yeah, are real. Well, somewhat. Did you know, after doing a little bit of research, on those judge shows, let's say that the plaintiff has to pay the defendant $500.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So let's say that has to happen. Actually, the show,
yeah,
pays that for them. The show pays it for them.
So you mean to tell me, when I hear all these verdicts and I'm like, yeah, boy, you got to pay, yeah, $900.
No.
Boy's not really paying $900.
No, the network's doing it for him.
Oh.
Yeah. That's really the only fake thing. Now, the case is real and the people are real and they really are getting a settlement. But here's the thing, though, here's what I love and the beauty about small claims court.
Yeah.
The beauty of small claims court, it is never about the money. It's all about the principle.
Yes.
Because I have seen judge shows on TV where somebody has sued somebody for $10. They've sued over something that cost $10, but it cost them $30 to make the lawsuit.
Yeah.
And that just proves that it's not about the money, it's about the principle.
You know, my absolute favorite of all time, Judge Judy, and if you've not watched it, we will definitely watch this together. A lady and her husband sold photos of cell phones for $250 a piece. But the people who bought these photos thought they were buying the phones. And to hear her explanation, Judge Judy's explanation as to why these people thought, she said, you'd think you had a PhD in lying, but you're wrong. You fail. And I laughed.
She used to tell people, she used to say, I'm smarter than you.
Oh, yeah.
She used to tell that. She's like, I'm a lot smarter than you. And she would ask people, she would say, do you think you're smarter than me?
Ooh, and that's such a question you don't want anybody to ask you.
No, but she would straight up tell you, I'm smarter than you, I'm more educated than you, and you're not going to trick me. And she would say, if you lie to me, you're going to wish you didn't wake up this morning.
Oh, yeah.
I will make it that way. And you got to think, you got to think how much power a judge has anyway.
Oh, yeah.
And Judge Judy is somebody that it was awesome to watch people squirm around.
Very much.
Against Judge Judy. But she paved the way for all of these great, great TV shows. Was she your favorite?
Actually, no. Judge Mathis was actually my favorite out of all of them. I don't know why. I think it's because my grandparents really liked him.
Judge Mathis. Hmm. They're doing too many now.
There's a lot. Yeah.
There's a ton of judge shows. Even Jerry Springer, which I said has went from being a talk show host to doing his own judge show. And I love Jerry. I do. But I don't really like his new show because it's been done to death.
Oh, yeah.
And really, only one person can do it and do it well, and that's Judge Judy.
Oh, yeah.
She is the queen of the courtroom TV shows. It's arguably that she is the queen of daytime television. I mean, her ratings speak for themselves.
Well, I have a question. So, you've established that the show typically pays for fines.
Yeah.
So, do they also pay, like, well, I guess, yeah, they would pay the settlements, too. So, what about if you have a settlement that's, like, 32, you know, like, in the thousands, they're going to pay that?
Well, small claims, I think small claims, you can't go over five, something like that. Or, wait, is it 5,000? 1,000, maybe? There's a certain limit. But, yeah, they'll pay it. You gotta think it's a network. They got millions of dollars. But Judge Judy, don't be sad. Like I said, her reruns will still be on the air, and she's said that she's not ready to retire just yet. She's just done with her courtroom TV show that she's done for 25 years. She's going to do a new show. She's taken a year off to be with her family, and she is going to come back and do a new show, and it's going to be called Judy Justice. I don't know the format of the show. It's probably not going to be a courtroom format, but it'll probably be something court related.
Oh yeah, or that she will do consulting. Maybe that would be fun.
Consulting, yeah,
yeah.
There was a show on back in the day. It was called Power of Attorney, and it was different than your regular judge show. It was about people would come, and it was like small claims court.
Yeah,
but they had their own lawyers representing them. So the lawyers got to shine, and the lawyers were fighting your case for you. So it was the plaintiff versus the defendant, and each of you had your own counsel. It was a really cool show.
Power of Attorney.
It got canceled.
When was that out?
It was early 2000s, mid-2000s. Okay. I saw it one day when I was home throwing up from school.
Okay.
Yeah, it's one of those. But yeah, Judge Judy, Judy Justice, coming sometime next year. Amber, before we take off the cuff song of the week break, we got a special guest here on today's episode. She's going to be joining us via the telephone, Donise Sheppard. She is an author. She is writing she's got a new book that's released.
She's got a new anthology book.
I didn't know what an anthology was until she told me. I didn't realize that it was a thing full of short stories.
Yeah.
I didn't realize what that was.
Yeah.
I never really majored in English. I took English 1 and 2, and that was it.
And you stopped there.
Yeah, I stopped. But they probably taught you what an anthology was in English 1.
I'm pretty sure that Stephen King taught me about all I know about anthologies.
Okay, but my English 1 class I do remember was my freshman year, 8 a.m.
Yeah, you wouldn't have learned it.
No. Who takes 8 a.m. classes? Freshmen.
Freshmen.
Because they don't know no better.
Exactly.
They think, I got up every day going to school.
High school.
That's different. It's different than high school.
A lot different than high school.
Because you're not out drinking until 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and have to get up, and then you're throwing up in a cup in your English class. Not saying I did that.
Thank you for that visual aid you gave me, too. That was a nice visual.
Absolutely. But Donise Sheppard is going to be joining us after Song of the Week break, and I really do look forward to that. Authors are just fascinating anyway, don't you think?
Yes, they are.
They're just fascinating people because
they create new worlds.
They do. They create characters.
Yes.
That you get to read. And she's going to talk about a book signing that she's got coming up that she's going to do at a local library. It would be really cool to meet, like, an author of the book you're reading.
Yes.
And really, any book you're reading, I think it would be cool.
Oh, yeah.
And when you think about, like, famous authors like E.B. White or R.L. Stein, Judy Blume, you think about...
I'm judging you for all of these authors you've chosen.
What?
I'm judging you for all of these authors you've chosen.
These are the only people that I can think of. What is... I just named really legendary authors.
What about Charles Dickinson?
Okay. I just couldn't think of him on the top of my head. I just couldn't think of him. What is wrong with Judy Blume and R.L. Stein and E.B. White? E.B. White wrote Charlotte's Web, and R.L. Stein wrote the Goosebumps series. And Judy Blume, what did she write? I know she wrote a bunch of stuff.
I'm going to let you handle that.
She wrote a bunch of stuff. But anyway, Donise is an author, and she writes romance books, and she writes horror books, like thrillers.
Yes.
And she's going to talk more about it when she comes on the show. So without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to take Off the Cuff's Song of the Week break. And you know what I can say and you can actually do?
I've been waiting on it.
You can roll down them windows, ladies and gentlemen, and enjoy Off the Cuff's Song of the Week break. We'll be back after the song. A lot of hate on this song right here. This is called Something Stupid by Lola Marsh. It's a good song, Amber.
I thought it was cute.
It's a beautiful song.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is a song that you want to roll down the windows and just drive down the road, enjoy the sunshine hitting you in the face. Because like I was telling you, Amber, before we came on the air, it's two different things when it's 65 and sunny.
Yep.
Because it can be 65 and very cloudy.
And rainy.
But it's today, it's 60 and sunny. So get out and enjoy the weather. enjoy it. All right, as promised, we got Donise Sheppard. She's an author, and she's going to be coming on the air after these words, so stick with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me. I'm throwing all kinds of bangers out.
Bangers.
Because it's sunny outside, I'm telling you. That's what it is.
Takes me back to riding the bus to high school.
Does it really?
Yeah.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, I want to introduce author Donise Sheppard. She is a romance and horror writer residing in southern West Virginia. She found her passion for books at an early age and has been chasing stories ever since. When she isn't working, she's reading for pleasure, baking, or singing off key. I like that little bio about her.
I do too.
Donise, I want to first of all say thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to be on Off the Cuff. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
It's my pleasure. So let me just go ahead and just state the elephant in the room. Well, actually, there's no elephant in the room because nobody knows this.
Exactly.
But Donise actually was one of my students. Now, most of my listeners know that I'm a college professor, and Donise actually had me in class, Amber. She's actually seen me in action as a teacher.
She's seen that side I haven't seen.
She has. So go ahead, Donise, and go ahead and let everybody know how fabulous and wonderful Adam Banks is as an instructor.
You are a very good teacher.
Did I make you feel inspired? Did I inspire you?
You taught me how to public speak, and it's probably because of your class I am able to do this interview.
Well, but and it's two different things, isn't it? Writing and speaking, wouldn't you say, is two very different things?
Yes, I could write all day long, but if I have to get up in front of a group of people and talk, I get really, really nervous.
Well, you know, like I tell you, the very beginning of class, people focus more on the public than they do the speaking. If you would just not focus so much on the public and you just focus on what you're saying, you will that will do wonders for you. But I'm not going to give a public speaking lecture. This is all about Donise right now. Donise, thank you so much. So I was talking about inspiration. What inspires you as a writer? Because when you're writing your material, you have to get your inspiration from somewhere. So where does it come from?
You can get inspiration from anywhere. Me personally, I'll either get it from other stories, whether they be books, music, TV, or even a picture.
Yeah. A picture but says a thousand words.
Your imagination.
Yeah, and that's the thing. So does a reader have to have a good imagination to enjoy a book?
I would say you do, mm-hmm. But if you start at an early age, then you build your imagination as you grow.
Well, let me ask. When you write your material, do you have a particular place that you want to go and write? Do you want to sit in front of a window? Do you like to go in front of a lake? Do you like writing at night? Do you like writing in the daytime? Where do you like to go, and when do you like to write?
I actually prefer to write in the morning before the kids wake up, and usually at my kitchen table. But I have written by a lake. And that is quite nice, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, I feel like that places like that gives you some inspiration. So let's talk about some of your work. Anthology is what they call it, right? Did I say that correctly?
Yes.
An anthology is a series of short stories. So let me just explain that to the audience. It's just an anthology is, it's got a theme, right? It's like the theme might be horror, the theme might be love, and it's just different short stories depending on the theme. Am I getting that right?
Yes.
Okay, and you've done a couple of those. What's your favorite thing about writing a short story compared to a big, long novel?
Short stories are really, really great for busy people, anybody who has, you know, a job or several jobs in your case, or kids. They don't have a lot of time. You can get the full emotion and the full story in a short story. And I prefer short stories over novels sometimes because you can get that from anthologies.
So just looking at some of your work here, Love Dust which is love stories, not all romance, but your story is romance. Magical reality, which is contemporary fantasy stories, but your story is romance. At Death's Door, which is a story about death and dying, and your story that you've got in here is a horror story. And that's actually the newest project that you're working on, correct?
Yes, it was just released.
Tell me a little bit about At Death's Door.
It has 24 different stories in different genres about death and dying. The genres range from fantasy to romance to horror.
What made you want to cover this topic?
We have tried different topics in the past, but we've bounced a few ideas back and forth. But we were both really excited. We had wanted to do the seven deadly sins, but that didn't quite work out. And we saw the death and dying, and we both really enjoyed that topic, so we chose to go with that one because you can do a lot with dying.
You know, I'm fascinated with death, and Amber is too. Don't give me that look. Don't give me that look. You're fascinated with death too. And I think everybody somewhat is fascinated with death because it's something that happens to everybody, right? Everybody's going to die. So do you think that, well, let me ask, while writing something like this, do you get crippling fear? Like, where you're constantly thinking about death? Are you getting scared at all? Like, thinking about it too much?
I'm not my characters. I write about different people, their story.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're completely made up. So I don't have to worry so much about their future and their problems, because this is just, it's about connecting with your readers on an emotional level. And writers, we get a kick out of scaring our readers or making them cry. There's actually no greater compliment.
Why?
Because it means you've reached them. If you can make someone feel what you feel whenever you're writing something, you have connected with another person on an intimate level.
So you're saying that's one of the biggest compliments that you could get as a writer?
Yes.
Okay, what I also find fascinating about you, Donise, is not only are you an author, but you have decided to become an entrepreneur and started your own publishing company. So this is really interesting for people who are out there maybe thinking about publishing their own work. They could actually possibly get published through your publishing company. Your publishing company is it's called Pixie Forest Publishing. Tell me a little bit about that and how that got started.
Well, we started it 2 years ago. There was me and another woman. She's no longer with Pixie Forest, but I have a new partner, Alan Ianson. And we basically just wanted to help other authors get paid. I started writing short stories, and none of the small publishing companies paid.
Yeah.
And as a writer, that's kind of an insult. You know, we spend hours writing and, you know, pouring our heart and soul into a story, and it's kind of an insult to not be paid for your work. And I wanted to change that. You know, right now we only offer $10 as payment, but it's something.
It is.
It's saying you're worth money. Your story is worth something.
Okay, so if I want to, or if anyone listening is wanting to get published, they can possibly come to you, correct? Now, tell me about how that process works.
Right now, we are only accepting short stories for our open calls for submissions. We just closed four submissions for our next anthology, Phobia, and we will be opening within the next couple months for a different theme that we have not announced yet. And you can locate our theme on our website and write a story in that theme under any genre and submit to our website for consideration.
That is amazing. And, and folks, it's not something that's just easy to do. You just can't, it's not one of these publishing companies that they're just going to publish anything that they get. Donise is very serious about this because I thought I could weasel my way into getting a story published. And I was like, hey, Donise, you want to publish me? She's like, hey, if it's good enough. And she did. I mean, she flat out told me that. And she said, she told me what she's telling everybody right now. You have to submit it to get it looked at. I mean, they're not going to publish just anything. I think that's great. And I think that you're doing something that's just fascinating because not everybody's doing that. And I honestly think that authors are some of the most interesting people in the world. And you are providing people a platform and providing people a service to get published. And you're giving people a chance. I love it. So I'm going to have all of your information. I'm going to have it all posted to the podcast. But just go ahead and tell everybody how they can find more information out about you and about your publishing company.
You can go to either website, either pixieforestpublishing.com or DoniseSheppard.com. And you can pretty much find anything from our books to what we're publishing to what I have published in the past. And contact me if you need.
At Death's Door, ladies and gentlemen, that's a new anthology of horror stories talking about death. I can't wait to get a copy. And speaking of, where can I get a copy of this new anthology?
We sell all of our books on Amazon, Kindle and paperback.
Kindle and paperback. Hey, let me ask, are you going to do what do they call those, Amber, audiobooks? Do they call
it like an audiobook?
Are you going to do an audiobook? Because, I mean,
we've got you a voice actor here.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, no, I wasn't trying to promote myself for that. I was just saying I'm more of a listener, I think, more than a reader. So, have you ever thought about possibly doing audiobooks, Denise?
I have considered it in the past. I've looked up, where I need to go and what I need to do. And I've definitely considered moving into the audiobook.
Love it. Well, there you go, ladies and gentlemen. That's Denise Sheppard. I want to thank you so much, Denise, for taking your time out to come on and promote the book, promote yourself, and promote that publishing company. I think it's good stuff. And come back. Don't be a stranger here on Off the Cuff. Thank you for listening. I know that you're a big fan.
I am. I enjoy the show. It always makes me laugh.
So let me ask. You have me and Amber here. Amber, say hi.
Hey, Denise.
Hi, Amber.
Who's your favorite?
Do I have to pick a favorite?
Oh, well, you know, I have control over the phone right now. So if you want to stay on the air, you know who to pick.
Denise, don't let that man hold you down. I'll call you on my phone.
Denise, thank you so much for taking the time out. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much.
All right. That was Denise Sheppard, ladies and gentlemen, an author. Check out her stuff at pixieforestpublishing.com or deniseshepherd.com. You can find Pixie Forest on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Pixie Forest Pub. Find Denise on Facebook at author Denise Sheppard and Twitter and Instagram at Denise Sheppard. You notice, Amber, how she put all of her handles under one name.
That's such a novel idea when people do that, Adam.
I know. And the paperback and ebook is available on Amazon if you want to buy her new book, At Death's Door. That's going to be a project that I would want to check out. And if you are an inspiring author, submit your work to Denise, and she will... Denise hung up on me. She must have picked you as her favorite. Submit your work to Denise, and she'll check it out and see if it's worthy to be published. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take one more break before we come back with our last segment. Stick with us. Everybody to Off the Cuff, last segment of the hour. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in the studio with me.
Great song.
That is Lady Gaga's newest song, Stupid Love. Lady Gaga, I don't think, has ever released a dud.
Well, I mean, she had a whole album that people kind of said was not art pop. People weren't very fond of that album.
This is very old school Lady Gaga.
This is 2007 Lady Gaga.
It is. The Just Dance, poker face Lady Gaga, yeah. Because she goes through phases. Yeah. And I think she tries to please all of her fans, so she plays different music. So, Amber, I've known you for years, so I'm pretty sure that you're not Catholic. You don't practice.
I thought about it one time, but no.
Okay. So, Lent, is apparently in now.
Yeah.
Lent season is in. And Lent is when you, and I don't know the rules because I'm not Catholic. But
now, I did participate in Lent 2 years in a row.
So that's what I was going to ask. Is Lent something you can participate in if you're not Catholic?
So at the time when I was participating in Lent, I was actively going to the Catholic Church. Yeah. Now, becoming a member of the Catholic Church is not as easy as, you know, just strolling in saying, hey, I'm Catholic.
Yeah.
You know, there are, you know, a few things you got to go through. So as far as it being, you can do it and not be an actual member, I like to think, yes, if you are going, if you're focusing on, I guess, the teachings of Catholicism. So when I did it, I had a good friend who, you know, has been Catholic her whole life. So she kind of held my hand and led me through it.
Yeah.
So it was easy for me to do it. But I do see that a lot of people do it just for giggles.
Well, I think that people like the idea of it because it's giving something up that you really, really like and you really enjoy, but you're sacrificing it to show honor towards God. Is that what it is?
Yes.
Okay.
So you agree to give something up for 40 days and 40 nights to show your commitment to God.
Okay. I like the idea. I do. I do like the idea of that. So I know I've seen a lot of people participating in that. And it's over, is it Good Friday?
Yes. So you go from Ash Wednesday to Good Friday.
And Ash Wednesday is like the week before when?
It was like 2 weeks ago.
So
yeah, Ash Wednesday happened like 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, and
yeah,
that's,
it looks like it was the 26th of February.
And that's where Mardi Gras comes from and everything, right? In New Orleans. That's what I heard. And the reason I know even this is because when I was doing the TV show Midday Kentucky on ABC 36 at 12:30, Mondays and Tuesdays, we were celebrating Fat Tuesday, which is Fat Tuesday, which is a cool day. You indulge
in everything you're going to give up,
and everything that you're going to give up before you give it up for 60 days or however. And so we were having people come on and talking about their Fat Tuesday deals that they had, and that was cool. So I do like the idea of this. It's pretty cool. Pretty cool stuff.
It's weird what people give up for Lent, though.
Yeah.
It's very weird. Most people give up, like, their gluttonous things, like their fast foods, their sodas.
Yeah.
I took it, like, the old school route and gave up intercourse for 40 days, 40 nights.
You have to give up things that you like. It's not, it don't count if you're giving up things that you don't really care about. Like, you can't give up onions if you hate onions.
But, yeah,
but like, if you enjoy sex, which most people do, but if you really enjoy
are you talking about me right now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I am. But if you really do, like Amber, you got to give that up and it will help.
And it was quite possibly the longest 40 days of my life.
And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with enjoying sex. That's a stigma. But we're going to have a whole episode one day on sex. Just FYI to everybody.
You said that so weird, but okay.
We are. We're going to have a whole episode on sex. But on that note, ladies and gentlemen, you know what time it is. It's time for Off the Cuff to start wrapping things up.
Guys, shut the studio down.
Shut the studio down. You can follow Off the Cuff on Facebook at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at The Adam Banks. Follow Amber at Ambu447 on Snap and Instagram. Ladies and gentlemen, starting in a couple of weeks, the March Madness series will be here. March 15th, we'll be doing a Selection Sunday show, posting it to the podcast feed, and then we'll be doing live radio shows discussing the March Madness tournament. It's going to be a good time. Can't wait for it. But that's it for this week. We'll be back next Thursday from 4 to 5. That is Amber Turner. I'm Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. We'll catch you down the road.